welcome to the news on Magic Bricks Now. I'm Suvesha Sawant. Let's take a look at the top headlines at this hour.
Mumbai Police Mumbai Shahar ke liye 144 CRPC Section 144 ke tahat prohibitory orders issue kiye hain.
Section 144 imposed in Mumbai for the next 15 days, which means there is a ban on more than five people gathering in public. The city is on high alert after possible threat of terror attacks. That's a Magic Bricks Now exclusive. India's newest state, Telangana, redraws its map on Vijayadashmi. The state gets 21 new districts, taking the total to 31 districts in all. What do Bengaluru citizens want to see in the upcoming BBMP budget? We get you exclusive details from the survey carried out under BBMP and Janagraha's My City, My Budget campaign. Also in the news, our campaign, Clean Your City. Today we find out why urban toilets are the need of the hour in Mumbai. And straight on to our big exclusive. Section 144 has been imposed in Mumbai for the next 15 days. This means there's a ban on any public gathering of more than five people without prior police permission. Mumbai is on high alert following a Union Home Ministry directive based on intelligence inputs that terror groups could carry out subversive activities and even try to trigger communal tension during the festive season. Following this, security has been beefed up in all the metro cities. My colleague Amitabh Balachandra caught up with Deputy Police Commissioner of Mumbai Operations, Ashok Dure, to know more of the security arrangements that have been put in place.
जहाँ पे विसर्जन places है, जैसे कि गिरगांव चौपाटी है, शिवाजी पार्क एरिया में चौपाटी है, जुहू चौपाटी है, वहाँ पे बड़े पैमाने पे हमने बंदोबस्त लगाया है। इस बंदोबस्त के लिए बाहर से पैरामिलिट्री फोर्सेस इनको भी हमने डिप्लॉय किया है, जो हमारे स्पेशलाइज फोर्सेस है इनको भी डिप्लॉय किया है। ट्रैफिक डिपार्टमेंट से जहाँ पे ट्रैफिक कंजेशन होने की आशंका है वहाँ पर भी बंदोबस्त लगाया है।
Also tell us now, we know that Section 144 is in place. Explain to our viewers what it means and how many days is it for?
Mumbai Police Mumbai Shahar ke liye 144 CRPC Section 144 ke तहत prohibitory orders issue किए हैं। इसमें पांच और पांच से ज़्यादा लोग इकट्ठा नहीं आ सकते हैं, लेकिन कोई भी आम आदमी या आम फंक्शन है तो वो कर सकते हैं। कोई रैली निकालना है, कोई प्रोटेस्ट करना है, तो उसके लिए अगर पांच से ज़्यादा लोग आते हैं तो उसके लिए परमिशन लेनी पड़ेगी। अगर विदाउट परमिशन कोई भी रैली, प्रोटेस्ट या आंदोलन होता है तो उनके खिलाफ हम कार्रवाई 144 के तहत सेक्शन 188 के तहत कार्रवाई करेंगे।
After all of the surgical strikes that we saw and the tension with Pakistan over the last couple of days, now we hear rumors of a possible terror attack in the city of Mumbai. How is the Mumbai police prepared for that?
मैंने अभी कहा, मुंबई शहर में कोई भी अगर आतंकी हमला या घातपात जैसे कार्रवाई होती है तो उसको निपटने के लिए मुंबई पुलिस की तरफ से पूरा इंतजाम हमने किया है। मुंबई शहर के सेवा में, मुंबई शहर के संरक्षण के लिए Mumbai Police 24 hours tayar hai.
One last question. Now I want you to give an advisory to all of the citizens, all of the viewers who are watching off Mumbai. What is the advisory that you will give them? Should they avoid crowded places over the next couple of days, or should they just work as usual?
No, actually, har jagah humne bandobast lagaya hai. Jo bhi crowded places hai, wahan par bhi humne bandobast lagaya hai. To Mumbai shahar ka jo nagrik hai, wo kahin par bhi ja sakta hai. आपको, आप जहाँ भी जा रहे हो वहाँ पे कोई अनअटेंडेड ऑब्जेक्ट या सस्पिशियस पर्सन आपको दिखता है तो तुरंत नज़दीक पुलिस स्टेशन में या ऑफिसर में या कंट्रोल रूम में आप कॉन्टैक्ट कर सकते हैं। कोई भी घटना हो तो उसके बारे में अगर कोई अफवाह या रूमर्स फैलने की कोशिश करता है तो उसको जो फैलने से रोके, सही जानकारी लेने के लिए आप तुरंत कंट्रोल रूम से कॉन्टैक्ट कर सकते हैं ताकि रूमर से मुंबई शहर में कोई लॉ एंड ऑर्डर की सिचुएशन ना हो।
Well, citizens in Mumbai need to take care. And while Mumbai is on high alert, intermittent firing continued well into the second day of the encounter in Pampore between militants and security forces. Militants had attacked the Entrepreneurship and Development Institute in Pampore, Jammu and Kashmir on Monday, setting fire in the campus to draw out security forces. The army responded swiftly, forcing the militants to remain within the EDI building. On day two, two terrorists were reported to be holed up in the government complex. Mir Farid sent us this report.
Firing has restarted here at the encounter site in Pampore. Now, this building, which has been in the line of fire since yesterday, is receiving more pounding from the side of the army. There you go, another massive blast, rockets being fired, and that really has been the scene since yesterday. There was a brief period of 1 hour that the firing had stopped. It seems that the security forces were re-strategizing, because since yesterday they have been firing non-stop, very heavy weaponry used, including rockets. Today the intensity was more, and that really has been the scene since yesterday. You can clearly see the building has been completely destroyed, and it has received a peppering of rockets and all kinds of explosives, including some IEDs that were detonated since yesterday. But still, it is very much intact, and there are around 70 rooms, as we've been saying. So this building is in a way acting as a concrete bunker for these militants, who interestingly have been lying low since yesterday. There are various scenarios that are developing here. One, of course, there you go, another massive blast, the rockets hitting the first or second floor of this particular building. And in fact, this building, which is a 7-floor concrete building, since yesterday, we've seen very little, if not any, firing from the militant side. Either they're lying low, or they may have been even killed by this firing. So there are various scenarios that are developing, but the fact that the army is continuing with this firing suggests that they are not sure whether the militants have been killed or not, and that's why they're continuing with this relentless barrage of rocket and grenade fire on this building. Now, that really has been the case for last 32 to 34 hours, ever since the encounter broke out.
Moving on, while festivals are also accompanied by high noise levels, but the good news is that Mumbai has recorded lower noise levels this year. Though the city is still way off the desired 60 decibel limit, and the prime culprits are political party-backed pandals, my colleague Aishwarya Paliwal caught up with Sumaira Abdulali of the Awas Foundation, which has been tracking noise pollution in Mumbai.
Give us a comparative analysis of how the noise is this year as compared to last year. What were the findings that you have with you?
Noise levels have gone down as compared to last year this year, a little bit. They're nowhere close to enough. Having said that, in some festivals, in certain routes and in certain areas, particularly politically controlled festivals, like for example at Ganpati, I found this year that most of the home Ganpatis were quiet. Many did not use loudspeakers, and they went, they did their immersion, and they didn't make noise. But there was still a lot of drums, and the political party mandals actually went way beyond the time limit. In spite of complaints, the police did not take action. So it's very selective.
In case people want to bring it to the level which is acceptable to the human body and it's not harming us, what are the steps that citizens should take?
You can download a free meter onto your phone. You just type in noise meter, download it, take the reading, take a photograph of the reading, and send it to the police, send it to Awas Foundation, either on our Facebook page, Get Well Soon Mumbai. The police have a Twitter account. You can email it to the police. Complain to 100, which is the police control room number. Get a complaint number, maintain a proper record, date, time, location, decibel level, photograph, and comments whether the police took action or not.
You're staying in an area where it's too loud. What are the kind of side effects that you will see on your body?
So noise pollution affects the heart, it affects blood pressure, mental health. We all know that road rage happens. We don't know why we are all so peaceful and friendly in other settings, but when it comes to traffic, suddenly we are all enraged at the slightest provocation. It could be noise. This happens in trains. There are fights every day. People scratch each other, pull hair, you know, get into really ugly fights. It could be the noise again. So it affects these things. Some doctors even say it leads to cancer.
This festive season, real estate developers across the nation have unveiled various offers to attract buyers. But how significant are these offers for you as a home buyer? My colleague Ruchi Deshpande gets us this special report.
With the real estate market under pressure and lowering demand, analysts believe that the biggest offers are from under construction properties where the demand is the lowest this festive season. Analysts say that the Delhi NCR market is in deep distress with low sales and has developers offering huge cash discounts to attract customers. For example, you have the Raheja Atharva in Dwarka Expressway with a discount of almost 20 lakh rupees.
We are giving from apartment to apartment and project to project. It is touching up to 30%. You can expect, you know, on an apartment which is worth 1 crore, you are getting it, say, far up to maybe even up to 70 lakhs only.
In the MMR or the Mumbai region, the developers are going big with the finance subvention schemes on the EMIs, that is, paying off a part of the consumer's loan interest. For example, Godrej Central project in Chembur is where you will pay 20% now and the rest on possession, or Wadhwa Group's project, that is the Atmosphere in Mulund, with no EMI till possession.
There is a financial or a package which is now being offered by pretty much all the development companies on across all projects, which includes either providing a very easy payment plan, idea being that put a small money down, and then over a period of time, either they're designing their own EMI plans or tying up with banks for subvention schemes.
Pune and Bangalore, however, are relatively more stable markets. They will offer small cash discounts. For example, we have Pune's Niyati Group Niyati Ilan in Wagholi giving you 200 rupees off per square foot, while Metropolis Properties in Bangalore offers a club membership on their Sarjapur project.
If you see Pune and Bangalore, they are into different placements of the time and space. Since the other money is also available, they haven't really doled out too many offers in the market. While in Mumbai, it's kind of a dry season for last 3 years. That's why the builders are more compelled to offer their discounts.
Given the continued financial stress with the advent of the Real Estate Regulatory Authority, industry experts advise that consumers should opt for almost complete or ready to occupy projects. This is Ruchi Deshpande for Magic Bricks Now.
Moving on to Bengaluru, which is in the middle of a unique exercise to get citizens to participate in the city's budget-making process. The BBMP and Janagraha's budget bus has travelled to 36 locations and recorded 5,000 suggestions from 9,000 citizens. So what does Bengaluru want its civic body to spend money on? Shrija gets us more details.
High-quality roads, effective drainage systems, timely desilting and security cameras. Well, these are some of the core areas where Bengaluru citizens want the BBMP to spend the budget money on. In fact, these are the inputs coming in from the volunteers of the budget bus. On a daily basis, the budget bus visits at least 6 residential areas, and on an average, they collect or gather about the inputs from the citizens anywhere between 700 and 800. Now, citizens from Kurubrahalli have asked or demanded for CCTV cameras to be installed in every nook and corner of the area. In fact, they have also voiced their opinion about desilting of the drains. Now, residents from some of the developed areas like the KHP Colony, Basaveshwara Nagar and Lalbagh Westgate and also Chandra Layout, they have asked for more green space and also repairing of ill-maintained footpaths. And citizens from Sumanahalli and Kamakshi Palaya, they have in fact asked for asphalting of the roads and also for effective drainage system to be put in place. Now, this budget bus has so far travelled to 36 locations and they have collected about 5,000 inputs from about 9,000 citizens. Now, you can also submit the input, and these inputs will be presented before the CM Siddaramaiah, Mayor G. Padmavati and some of the civic heads, and later it will be incorporated into the BBMP budget. In Bengaluru, Shrija for Magic Bricks Now.
On the occasion of the Sera, India's newest state, Telangana, has redrawn its map, carving out 21 new districts in the state. In a grand celebration, Telangana Chief Minister K. Chandrasekhar Rao formally inaugurated Siddipet district, which is also his home district, and his cabinet colleagues inaugurated the other districts. The new districts include Mancherial, Nirmal, Asifabad, Jagdial, Pedapalli, Sirisilla, Warangal, Bhupalpalli, Janagaon, Mehboobabad, Kotagudam, Sangareddy, Vanaparthi, Nagakurnool, Garhwal, Suryapet, Yadadri, Vikrabad and Mirchal. In fact, me on Magic Bricks Now had been telling you for nearly 6 months on how the state has been in the process of deciding on the new districts. Telangana, which has a population of 3.5 crores, was carved out of Andhra Pradesh on the 2nd of June 2014. As the administration gears up for the revamp, the IT department is working against tight deadlines to create websites for all the new districts. Even the collectors for the same have been appointed. Moving on, a home for every Indian and a little over 3 years to do so. Tall order. But that is also why the government has turned to technology for the answers. My colleague Deepa Rana gets us this report on just how the Ministry for Urban Development plans to build those 9 crore homes.
From the outside, it looks like any other conventional building, but it is more than that. Built from scratch in 10 days and at a cost of anywhere between 1200 to 3000 rupees a square foot using prefabrication technology. The centre is pitching this as the answer to India's housing problems.
Prefab technology are like modular kitchen in our homes. The pieces are manufactured off-site and assembled on-site. These houses can be built in approximately 10 days with minimum resources.
It will help to expedite the construction. The idea of this exposition park is to demonstrate to the country and to the people what are different types of technologies that are available, which are safer, which are cheaper comparatively. The purpose is because you need to act fast. You have a target of 2022 housing for all. It's a gigantic task, but it's not impossible if we all join together.
Even the developers believe this technology is key to mass producing houses. The government aims to build 2 crore affordable homes in rural areas and 6 crore homes in cities over the next 5 to 6 years. Prefab construction technology is expected to accelerate the process of building these homes.
Costs become an important issue here. Initially, the costs may be slightly, it might compare slightly differently as compared to conventional, but if you take it to scale, then the costs will become competitive. Once these issues have been addressed and taken care of, then I think this prefab and precast technology will become quite popular in achieving the mission of housing for all.
To the government, prefab technology is an answer to meet the housing needs of the country. These houses are not only cheaper and quicker to make, but are also earthquake resistant. This is a reason why the Bureau of Indian Standards will include one of these technologies as part of National Building Code. What's more, the government is also mandating that the government agencies must use these technologies to build housing for all or affordable homes by 2022. This is Deepa Rana for Magic Bricks Now in New Delhi.
Moving on to our campaign, Clean Your City. Today's story comes from the financial capital, Mumbai, where all the money in the world is not enough to build toilets for every citizen. Disha Shah gets us this report of a chawl that is still waiting for the BMC to build a toilet that it was promised 6 months back under the Swachh Bharat Abhiyan.
This is how residents staying in Manbhai Keshavwadi chawl in Bhandup West start their day, by queuing up to use the toilet. Reason, the 80 families and about 400 residents of the society share only one common toilet, which is used by both men and women. Most families lack toilets in their own homes. Apart from the obvious inconvenience this causes, the single toilet also generates its own social concerns.
Common toilet mein kya hota hai, bahut sara issue hota hai. Cleaning barabar kabhi kabhi nahi hota hai. Pani ka pressure kam hota hai, kabhi kabhi pani nahi milta hai wash karne ke liye. फ्लश करने के लिए नहीं मिलता है तो उसकी वजह से क्लीन नहीं हो पा रहा है
प्रॉब्लम ये है कि ये कॉमन है जेंट्स और लेडीज़ एक ही है तो प्रॉब्लम ऐसा आता है कि लेडीज लोगों को ज़्यादा प्रॉब्लम आता है दूसरी बात ऐसा एक कॉमन समझ के जो बाहर के लोग जाते हैं बाहर के उनको लगता है कि अपना ये म्यूनसिपैलिटी का टॉयलेट है। अभी लड़के लोग बड़े होते जा रहे हैं तो घर में टॉयलेट हुआ तो उनके लिए लड़के लोगों के औरत लोगों के लिए अच्छा है।
In fact, under the Swachh Bharat Abhiyan scheme, close to 2.23 lakh crore rupees, that's the budget allocated to build toilets across the country. And if you talk about the financial capital, 74 crore rupees, that's the budget allocated to build toilets across the city. In fact, the scheme also states that all such housing societies which has one common toilet will be given 2000 rupees per family to build that additional toilet in their household. But if you talk about such housing societies, the ground reality is way too different.
In fact, Manbhai Keshav Wadi is among those chawls that the BMC reached out to and offered to construct one more toilet. This is in addition to the civic body's plans to equip all existing toilets in Mumbai with running water and electricity. But like many of the civic body's plans, these two have stayed on paper.
हमारे यहाँ पहले सिर्फ फॉर्म भरने आए, उसके बारे में कोई डिटेल हमको पता नहीं है। सिर्फ तभी बोला गया था कि गवर्नमेंट की तरफ से फ़ंड मिलेगा और आप टॉयलेट घर पे बनाइए, पर बाद में कोई आया नहीं है, कुछ उसके आगे प्रोग्रेस हुआ नहीं है। और सेकेंडली, अगर 2000 मिलता भी है तो 2000 में टॉयलेट बनना इम्पॉसिबल है। मतलब यहाँ पे कोई ऐसा है ही नहीं कि मतलब 2000 में कोई टॉयलेट बना सके। तो गवर्नमेंट सिर्फ बोलती है पर वो चीज़ का कुछ इम्प्लीमेंट हो नहीं रहा है।
2000 रुपये आप जो बोल रहे हैं, 2000 तो अभी तक किसी को मुनाफा मिला तो है नहीं। अगर 2000 रह के भी अगर घर में अगर हमारे मिलते हैं तो भी उसके पीछे हमारा 18 से 20 हज़ार रुपया खर्चा बढ़ जाता है। तो अगर 2000 के सामने हमारा 15-18 हज़ार हमारे जेब के जाएंगे, मतलब नहीं है सब चीज़ का।
2 years down the line and most of these housing societies are still waiting for 2000 rupees, the budget that was allocated by the, that was promised by the government to most of these housing societies to build that additional toilet either in premises or household. However, they say that 2000 is a very minimal amount. It at least takes 9 to 10,000 rupees to build that additional toilet. Lastly, what is more important here is that BMC's implementation under the Swachh Bharat Abhiyan seems to be good, but at the end of the day, most of these policies still remain on paper. This is Isha Shah reporting here for Magic Bricks Now.
Please join our campaign, Let Us Clean Our Cities Together. Our cities are an extension of our own home. This festive season, it's time for us to pick up the broom and sweep our city clean. Our contact details are flashing on your screen. Send us photos, videos, or you can even call us. We will come to your location and find out how you're doing your bit, making a Swachh Bharat. Moving on, while the city of Jaipur is grappling with high number of chikungunya cases, Pujo Pandals in Kolkata have been fined for stealing electricity. Let's take a look at what's making news across the city.
Pujo Mandals in Kolkata have been drawing power illegally. The West Bengal State Electricity Distribution Company has fined 1,823 pandals out of the 5,751 pandals to the tune of 31 lakhs for the same. Chikungunya is back with a vengeance. 1,074 cases have been recorded in Rajasthan since 2016, with a maximum number of 800 cases from the city of Jaipur. Karnataka, Maharashtra, Delhi and Uttar Pradesh have also been badly hit by the outbreak. Ganga water will not be supplied to Noida and Ghaziabad until 9th November, since the UP Irrigation Department has closed the upper canal of the river to carry out annual desiltation. Nearly 7 lakh people in Indirapuram, Vasundhara, Vaishali and Delta colonies of Ghaziabad and close to 8 lakh residents of Noida who depend on Ganga Jal for their potable needs have been affected. Kaveri dispute takes a toll on KSRTC earnings. The Kaveri water sharing dispute, which saw violence and stone pelting incidents, has led to a drop in Kerala State Road Transportation Corporation's earning. A per day loss of approximately 3 lakh rupees has been recorded during the Onam week. Officials attribute the hit in earnings to last-minute trip cancellations to Bengaluru and ticket fares that have been refunded to the passengers.
Talking about interiors now, with the festive fever gripping everyone, this week on the Trending Interiors, we tell you how you can set up your table using silverware. Listen in to making your next party elegant and extremely classy. and a very warm welcome to a new episode of Trending Interiors. I'm Aishwarya Paliwal. I'm outside Studio 54, which has brands like Kala, which is German porcelain, and Grigioi, which is Italian silverware. Also inside is Ronita, who's the editor-in-chief of Good Homes. She has kept a dining table setting ready for us with the use of a lot of silverware. So let's go inside and check out all the combinations that maybe you can use the next time you're hosting a party. Hi, Ronita.
Hi, Aishwarya. How are you doing?
I'm doing very well. You know, by looking at this table, I'm feeling hungry now.
That's the whole point. A well-set table is half your job done when it comes to entertaining and, you know, having people over for dinner. We're trying to throw light on silverware, on how beautiful, how useful, and how very, very elegant silverware can make your evening and your dinner tables.
So tell me, what are the different elements that I can see right now on this table?
Very basic, very basic formal sort of setting. You've got the underplate, which is in silver.
Okay.
I've got you two options. You've got the silver underplate and you've also got the porcelain underplate, which is part of your dinner set. And then you've got your dinner plate, you've got your soup bowl. There's also something called a quarter plate, which goes on the side.
Okay.
We haven't used that because the table is small. It's a very intimate setting.
For four.
And again, it's my way of very subtly telling you guys that there are no rules. Yes, there needs to be a quarter plate, but you know what? If you don't want it, it doesn't have to be there. That's the whole idea. You've got to be comfortable in your skin with whatever it is that you're doing. Your centerpiece, this is another element of the table that, according to me, is just so necessary because it makes the whole theme come together.
So apart from this, are there any other centerpieces that you would recommend for a setting like this?
If you like flowers, then you go with various options for those flowers. There's, if it's a dinner table, then we can also look at a lovely, sort of multi-candle setting. You can have individual candle stands with individual candles for each place setting. So you can personalize it in various ways.
Thank you so much, Ronita.
Thank you.
And in Mumbai, Parmeshwar Godrej, philanthropist and wife of Godrej Group Chairman Adi Godrej, breathed her last at Mumbai's Breach Candy Hospital following a degenerative lung illness. The 72-year-old socialite was known for her contribution to creating awareness about AIDS with Hollywood actor Richard Gere. She also launched the Heroes Project to fight HIV/AIDS in India. Parmeshwar was active in the Godrej Group in the last couple of years with her aesthetic and design contribution in Godrej Properties and Godrej Consumer. And that's all we have on the news on Magic Bricks Now. Thank you so much for watching.
You can watch live TV on our website, mbnow.in. Find us on Facebook at facebook.com/magicbricksnow. And don't forget to click the like button. You can also follow us on Twitter at Magic Bricks Now. To stay updated with all our programming, hit the subscribe button on our YouTube channel by logging on to youtube.com/magicbricksnow.